So how does Philips define their design challenges? Well, actually, Philips is huge, obviously. We're a very big company, and there's many kinds of design challenges that we need to cater for. And you see that in all of these environments, we slightly adjust our methodology. Obviously, the methodology is always directed by the environment and the kind of project that we're dealing with. But typically, you could say that in the definition of our design challenges, we find it very important to look at the total user journey of an eventual end user. And basically see that this user goes through his experience with our propositions over time. And we try to map out basically how this current proposition, how he's currently using this proposition over time in a thing that we call our experience flow, but it's quite similar to what other people often refer to as a user journey. So we map out these user journeys and we try to then see, okay, how can we improve upon this user journey? Where are the opportunities? Where new needs arise of these people? Where does the environment of these people actually change? And we let ourselves being informed by these needs of people, by how the environment is actually shaping, and also our business requirements. They're a very important factor in defining the design challenge. Obviously, we still are a commercial company. We need to make money with these propositions. So also we need to think about how this proposition differentiating from our competition. Where do we put it out to the market? What is our market introduction planning process? Where are we going to put it out on, into which kind of markets, into which kind of channels? So all of those things are actually part of our design challenge. It's a very complex mix of requirements that we try to map out. And it's very difficult to try to consolidate all those requirements into a document, into a Word file or a PowerPoint file. Because if I would be writing that PowerPoint or my colleague would be writing the PowerPoint, our language is slightly different. So it's very ambiguous. My list of requirements might be very differently perceived from his list of requirements. So what we really hope to do in each of these projects is to actually try to envision this future scenario. Think from the end user point of view. And in this envisioned scenario, we map out what the desired future use of our propositions are. Because in the end, all the different disciplines that are involved in a design program, so we have our design disciplines, our engineering disciplines, our marketing, our sales disciplines, and quite often, actually in these days, also we have our end users involved in the design process. It's very important that everybody understands the design challenge from one common point of view. So not just the marketing part and the engineering part of your design challenge, it needs to be consolidated into one big thing. And this is what we refer to as a preferred scenario of use. It's captured in an experience flow that explains the future use of a particular proposition in great detail along a scenario. Okay, so like I explained, Philips is a very big company and there's many diverse design challenges. And maybe it's good to think of a couple of these examples. You could think like within Philips Lighting, we have a proposition called U. And our proposition is actually containing hardware, so the actual light bulbs, software, for example, the apps, but also the native software that controls the light bulbs. And a service proposition. So on top of all of your U use, you can buy additional services that make it even more fun, more engaging, and more meaningful to use U. So this is on one end of the spectrum. On the other end of the spectrum, we're also very active in healthcare. And Philips Healthcare has very complex propositions with regard, for example, to diagnosis and clinical decision support. So we make our MRI and CT scanners that actually help therapists to make a diagnosis for treatment. And this entails not only the hardware, so the MRI scanner and the CT scanner, but it also includes an entire software package that helps them designate what the particular cause or disease is, but also allows them to set up a treatment plan, for example. So you see that our propositions are very diverse and contain many different elements, but quite often at least contain both hardware, software, and services. So when we are actually setting our design challenge and listing our requirements, it's very important to not just focus on documentation, Word files and PowerPoint files to try to capture everything in text, because text is quite ambiguous. All the disciplines that are involved in a design program, so designers, engineers, marketeers, salespeople, but more and more also our actual end users, they're involved in our design processes. It's very hard to come up with a format. It's very good to come up with a format that is actually losing this ambiguity that everybody understands from all the different disciplines. So that's why we are actually establishing our design challenges and listing our requirements in future scenarios. In these future scenarios, we try to map out how an end user is basically interacting with a proposition over time in all of the different contexts of use. So he might, in the pre-purchase experience, interact with a proposition already in store or online. At purchase, obviously, he needs to buy it and unpack it. And in actual use, he's continuously interacting with the proposition in his actual environment. So that might be home, might be in a hospital. And it's very important to map these different contexts of use, the different ways that a user is interacting with your proposition over time, and try to list requirements for the proposition with regard to that particular context of use. So in any design challenge and any innovation project, you always have to deal with a large degree of uncertainty. This is normal, otherwise it wouldn't be an innovation project. And actually, there's many ways to deal with this uncertainty, and a couple pieces of advice perhaps. I think when you set your design challenge, it's always very good to basically reflect upon how you set your design challenge with relevant peers, experts, maybe your colleagues, maybe the fellow students that you're working with, and basically see if they agree in the way that you've set your design challenge. We do this all the time. When we set a design challenge, we will basically interact with different stakeholders from different disciplines and just validate whether it makes sense or doesn't make sense. Then, whatever you do, your design challenge will always have will remain a level of uncertainty. So it's good to just start actually designing the propositions and materialize your ideas. Then if you have an initial prototype, an initial sketch, maybe a fully workable demo, those are great moments in time to actually engage with the end users and let them basically reflect upon what you did and see if it's truly meaningful for them and if they would be willing to take up that proposition in their daily lives. So I think you deal with uncertainty through iteration. So sometimes through iterations with experts and sometimes through iterations with actual end users. So I understood that you guys are really focusing on the end user needs, and I think that is indeed the primary and most important part of your requirements. If there's no end user need that you're fulfilling with a future proposition, there's no need to make the proposition at all. But in a company like Philips, there's many other dimensions to making your list of requirements. There's many business requirements. How can we actually make money off this? There's many requirements coming from our marketing and sales organizations. How do we want to place this proposition within a shop or within a web environment? And there's also many requirements that actually are just due to the way that we're organized. And for example, how do we need to collaborate with the different disciplines in the company? Where do we hand over from design to engineering and to marketing? And I think all of those things are part of a very holistic and good design challenge.